Oops. Today is Monday, and September the 11th, 2023, and the time is 6 o'clock. This regular meeting of the Mesquite ISD Board of Trustees is being called to order. A quorum is present and a notice of the meeting has been posted for the time and the manner required by law. At this point in time, we will move into a closed session under the authority of Texas Code Sections 551.071 for consultation with the board and the attorney. Okay, are you ready? Is Ken Griffiths here? There he is, thank you. In session, and if you will stand please for our invocation by Reverend Ken Griffiths and our Pledge of Allegiance. Oh, there you are.
Father God, we seek today your presence, your guidance. We ask that you help those who make decisions and deliberate today do it always in the interest of our children. We ask that those who will be awarded today, Father, will be grateful for this school district that's allowed this to happen in their lives. Father, we thank you for this opportunity and again pray your blessing. And I do ask, Father, for each of these that sit in a decision-making process, that they would allow you to guide them, Lord. So, Father, we just thank you again, and we ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Going to bring our colors.
Colors, attention. Derek, colors. Forward, march. Left, 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 right. Left, 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 right. Left, march time. March. Left. Color card, halt. Center, face. Post.
Please join me for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to the Texas, one state under God, one and indivisible.
Order, arm, pose. Right face, forward, march, left.
I want to say thank you very much to the JROTC from Vanguard High School. So,
thank you.
Welcome to our meeting tonight. We are looking forward to a great meeting this evening. Our first thing is our board moment, and Ms. Collier?
I had time this week to visit a couple libraries, and well, last week. And you go in, and it is like this warm, welcoming space where it's just a little happy spot. And you go in, and it's alive, and it's colorful, and watch my son go and pick him a book. It's a grace. It's a gift that we underutilize, but it was absolutely magnificent. So high five to our librarians for being rock stars. So
yes, they truly are. They truly are. Yeah, several of us, I think, attended some of the football games. So it's been an eventful month, and and school has started, and we're on track. We're ready to go. So, all right. Anything else for our board moment? Congratulations. Tell us why I'm saying congratulations to you.
The Texas Association of School Boards nominating committee decided to give me the nomination for position 10B to sit on their board of directors.
Woohoo! The reason that's such a big deal, it gives Mesquite ISD a statewide voice. So we look forward to your service. Thank you so much.
And he's so quiet.
Yes, he is. We appreciate it. We appreciate it very much. Anything else for a board moment? Okay. Our student and staff guest.
Okay, test. We're going to begin by honoring our Apple Corps nominees for this evening for the month of September. And we have a brief video to introduce each of them to you. So from Henry Elementary School, please meet Connie Martinez Duran. She is a kindergarten bilingual teacher with 17 years of experience, with 10 of those in Mesquite ISD.
Ms. Duran is an exceptional educator who truly makes a difference across our campus. Every day, she spreads positivity, she gives 100%, and most importantly, she embraces change to ensure she's meeting the needs of her students and her colleagues. Her passion for education shines through daily in her classroom and as she leads her colleagues. We are truly blessed to have Ms. Duran as part of our Henry family. Congratulations, Ms. Duran, on being selected as the Henry Apple Corps teacher.
I have a passion and calling for teaching, and I think it's important because I have the privilege of teaching my students and building the foundation and helping them learn in two languages. I love working with children and teaching them and building relationships with them so they can become productive, kind, and successful citizens of our community and our society.
Connie, if you'll come forward, it's my privilege to be able to present this proclamation on behalf of the board. Whereas the Mesquite Independent School District Board of Trustees seeks to honor outstanding classroom teachers who demonstrate leadership, innovation, and dedication to the students of Mesquite ISD, and whereas the Mesquite ISD Apple Corps consists of exceptional teachers nominated by their peers to receive the school district's highest recognition. Therefore, be it resolved that the board officially welcomes Connie Martinez Duran into the Mesquite ISD Apple Corps on this 11th day of September 2023. Connie, congratulations. Thank you for all you do.
Good evening. I would like to start off by thanking God first and foremost for the opportunity to serve in Mesquite ISD. Thank you, members of the board, Dr. Rivera, my family, my colleagues, but most importantly, my students. It is because of them that I come to work every day with a smile on my face. My students, mentors, admin, and colleagues have all helped and encouraged me along the way. Those who know that everything that I do it willingly and with the best attitude possible. And like I always tell my children and my students, hard work pays off. You may not see it at first, but in the long run, it does, if they keep pushing forward. Gracias por su apoyo. Thank you, everyone. Have a blessed evening.
Our next honoree this evening is Stephanie Cruz from Shands Elementary. She is a third grade bilingual teacher with 27 years of teaching experience, and 22 of those have been here in Mesquite.
Every campus needs a Mrs. Cruz. Stephanie is considered by her peers to be a leader at Shands Elementary. She not only excels in the classroom as a teacher, but she is a leader at Shands through our Shands Student Council. As an MISD ETIP campus scholar, Mrs. Cruz has helped lead our student council and helped numerous Shand Sharks develop leadership skills that will follow them through their lives. Mrs. Cruz is dedicated to her profession. Most importantly, she is a positive influence on our staff and students. She almost always has a warm smile, and her witty sense of humor is a welcoming addition to our school. Mrs. Cruz will be a great member of the MISD Apple Corps group.
I believe teaching is important because the education the students receive will have a lasting impact throughout their lives. In addition to academics, as a teacher, I help students learn to have empathy, show kindness, and respect others' differences.
I didn't have to call you up here, did I, Stephanie? Well, Shands is a very special school for our family because my son and daughter went through Shands. My two oldest granddaughters have gone through there, and my third granddaughter is now at Shands in the fourth grade. So it's a very special school for us, and go Sharks. Whereas the Mesquite Independent School District Board of Trustees seeks to honor outstanding classroom teachers who demonstrate leadership, innovation, and dedication to the students of Mesquite ISD. And whereas the Mesquite ISD Apple Corps consists of exceptional teachers nominated by their peers to receive the school district's highest recognition, therefore be it resolved that the board officially welcomes Stephanie Cruz into the Mesquite ISD Apple Corps on this 11th day of September, 2023. Congratulations. We're very proud of you. Be careful.
Good evening. Thank you to Dr. Rivera and the MISD board members for honoring me and for always making decisions that exemplify excellence always for all students and staff in Mesquite ISD. Thank you to all my students over the past 27 years who have taught me to be a better teacher. It is so rewarding to see their growth every year. Thank you to my Shands family for this nomination and recognition. I am very fortunate to work with such a great group of educators. Thank you, Brandy Lewis, for your unwavering support and leadership over the years. Thank you to my current third grade team and all my past teammates and colleagues. It has been a privilege learning from and collaborating with all of you. Special thanks to Jill Furr, Candace Hudson, Muriel Ortiz, Robert Cerber, Brenda Tafer, and Kay Velarde for always being there for me. I would like to thank my family, my husband George, who helps me set up my classroom every year and has a true understanding of what it's like to live with a teacher. My daughter Olivia, who has helped me get ready for each school year and keeps me current on all new trends so I can pretend like I'm cool in front of my students. My siblings who support me by purchasing things from my classroom, from my Amazon wish list. And finally to my parents, my mom who is here tonight and my father who passed away last year. They always provided an environment for me and my siblings in which our education was a primary focus. Again, thank you for this honor. I will always be grateful.
Thank you. Ms. Cruz, would you have your family and Shans stand, please? Yeah, there you go. Ms. Duran, we didn't do that. Could you introduce your family, or are they here? All right. Thank you. For a special moment, I'd like to talk. Have Dr. Rivera give us pause
yes.
for a moment.
Yes. Could everyone please stand? 22 years ago, something happened in our nation, and I want to have a minute of silence in remembrance of that event. So please bow your heads and a minute of silence for the 9/11. Thank you very much. We wanted to make sure that we remember all the lives that were lost in 2001.
All right. In just a moment here. Okay. Each month, we take a moment to recognize one of our outstanding paraprofessionals on our campuses, and tonight is no exception. I'd like to call forward Mr. Ronald Dodd and his principal from Berry Middle School. And I believe Ms. Wiggins is going to tell us about what makes Mr. Dodd so special.
Board, Dr. Rivera, and other cabinet members, thank you so much for recognizing Ronald Dodd as an MISD star para. He is starting his fourth year at Berry Middle School and his sixth year with Mesquite ISD. Mr. Dodd serves as a SPED special education para on our campus and a volunteer boys athletic coach. Mr. Dodd, aka Coach Dodd, is a valuable Berry family member. He goes above and beyond and offers help and support wherever needed. He is the epitome of see a need, address a need. In addition to performing his roles and responsibilities as a standout SPED para on our campus, he mentors and pours into all of our students each and every day. He is a constant in the hallways, classrooms, and all common areas. He can diffuse any situation with comedy and laughter. But most importantly, he is a listening ear for many of our staff and students, always offering sage advice. His kindness and big heart make him one of a kind, and Berry Middle School is grateful to have him as part of our family.
We love you, Ronald.
Hello, everybody. How y'all doing today? Giving honor to God and everybody on the board, I just want to say that everything I do, I try to lead with my heart. I'm not a person that really likes to speak, but, you know, being here tonight, it's a good feeling because I know how my parents raised me to be. it just led me to, you know, move how I move. Some of the kids I work with, they always ask me, Mr. Dye, why you, you know, tuck your shirt in? Why your pants so high? I tell them, you know, it's about, you know, how you look in some situations, in certain places in the world, you know? You got to look the part before you even speak. So that's just something that in me. I've been at it for a minute. I got the opportunity to teach for a year. Within that year, I didn't pass the test that I needed to, but I stayed locked in to what I needed to do. And I stood strong, and I'm here now, and I was able to get this award. So I just want to read something and lead this with you. Never give up. Once you get the faith to start walking out God's crazy word, it may take a minute to get there. And let's be honest, waiting sucks. But waiting doesn't mean sitting around scrolling Twitter or binge watching HBO. Waiting means service. Get used to saying, how can I help? Do you need anything else? Don't waste your wait. The wait is where God makes you into who you need to be when he gets you there. I'd like to thank my Berry family who's here. They can stand up. And most importantly, I'd like to thank my dad and my sister. Can y'all please stand up? Thank y'all.
Our next recognition for the evening is of our Read, Play, Talk Partner of the Month. And I'd like to introduce, well, we're going to play you a video first and then have the mayor of Mesquite, Mr. Dan Alamon, come forward. So here's a little video.
This month, we are recognizing Mayor Daniel Alamon Jr. for hosting the Mayor Summer Reading Challenge.
When I heard the superintendent talking about how children need to continue to read during the summer, and that they can actually get a little bit behind, and that passion and desire to keep kids reading during the summer.
At the end of the challenge, the mayor hosted a celebration at the Mesquite Public Library for all of the children that completed the summer reading challenge.
I also know where we're coming from. I know we went through COVID, and I know it's taken a little bit to get back on top and doing things so the parents could read those pages to them and it would count and encourage them to get together, read, play, talk.
The mayor plans to bring this program back next summer, and with more time to plan, he's excited to make next year bigger and better.
So we'll do a big party again, a kickoff party, inviting kids to come, and then also a party to celebrate their accomplishment, give them certificates, do another pizza party, and give them some gift bags. Whatever we can do to encourage these kids, we're there.
Thank you, Mayor Alamon, for your support of Read, Play, Talk, and for encouraging our kids to read over the summer.
I want to say thank you so much. This is so cool. It really is so neat. I want to tell you, first of all, that I am so proud of this school board and the superintendent. I'm a big time, and I say this as the mayor of Mesquite, I'm a big time supporter of the Mesquite Independent School District. I have three adult children that they went to Thompson Elementary, one of them did. They went to Berry Middle School. They went to Terry Middle School, they went to Horn High School, and they went to Mesquite High School. So my kids grew up in the schools, graduated in schools, and now I have a granddaughter that's attending also a middle school. So I'm very proud. And I'm very proud to know our school board members as well. I look at them right now, and just to be able to say that I know them personally, I'm grateful for that. And the superintendent as well. And I appreciate your leadership, and I appreciate your character and your integrity. We're so thankful and grateful to have you as leaders in our city. And I say that from my heart. I also want to say, I want to give praise to God, to the Lord Jesus Christ for this award, because he's the one that gives us ideas and things to do. And I had heard the superintendent talking about keep the children reading during the summer. And then all of a sudden, this idea just came during my prayer time. Have a reading challenge for the children during the summer. And I know I had seen that probably somewhere before growing up. So I only had 2 weeks before school was over when this idea started working and moving. I started going to elementary schools, talking to principals, saying, hey, I want to do this. I think we can do it. We need to keep our children reading during the short summer that we have. And lo and behold, when it was all said and done, because we had a big kickoff and the children came to the library, but we had 250 children that did the challenge, 1,000 pages that they read during the summer. And I got real excited about that. And we had a big party. We had a big party at the main library. We had pizza. We had bags that we gave out to the kids. And I got to meet these precious families. This was just simply an idea that came forth. So I am very grateful and thankful for this recognition. Thank you so much for this. And I want to tell you, before I go, I'm a big-time Lindsay Paris fan. She's doing an awesome job. And we need this read, play, talk moving constantly because it's so important for our young children. We want them right on track by the third grade, so we continue to work on that. So, Superintendent, again, thank you for this privilege and this honor, and thank you for this recognition. Thank you, school board. Appreciate it. Thank you. All right.
And now we're going to start recognizing some students.
Tonight, we're going to begin with our Library Services Summer Reading Program, and there are some trophies there on the table for these students. First, from Tosh Elementary School is Elijah Kampsik. He's the top elementary reader, and he recorded over 27,000 pages. Next, from Berry Middle School is Nawal Adebayo, the top middle school reader, who recorded over 17,000 pages. Next, from Mesquite High School is Rebecca Price, our top high school reader, who recorded over 5,000 pages. Next, from McKenzie Elementary School is Kelly Coldwell. She is our top elementary school staff reader, and she read over 18,000 pages. From Vanston Middle School is Anna Waugh, top middle school staff reader, and she recorded over 26,000 pages. From North Mesquite High School, Lynn DeVita, she's our top high school staff reader with 20,000 pages. Okay, I'm sorry, I got off track. Now we're gonna begin recognizing our AP scholars. These students receive scores of 3 or higher on 3 or more AP exams. And this is Kimberly Ibarra from John Horn High School. Also from John Horn High School is Natalie Lopez, AP scholar. Raul Reyes, John Horn High School, AP Scholar. From Horn High School, Leilani Saldivar, AP Scholar. from Horn High School, Pablo Almanza, AP Scholar. From Horn High School, Leslie Gonzalez, AP Scholar. From Horn High School, David Gutierrez, AP Scholar. Also from Horn High School, Jacob Hammett, AP Scholar. From Horn High School, Emma Jeffcoat, AP Scholar. From Horn High School, Andrea Noacolo, AP Scholar. Horn High School's Adrian Parada, AP Scholar. And the final AP Scholar from John Horn High School, Diego Rodriguez Castro. These next students are from Mesquite High School and are also AP Scholars, Deborah Carvalho. Damani Babineau, AP Scholar. Camden Rensick, AP Scholar. Moving on to our North Mesquite High School AP Scholars, this is Marisol Nieto. AP Scholar Cruz Trejo. AP Scholar Diego Amador Garcia. AP Scholar Gamila Andrews. AP Scholar Fidel Ramirez. And now Poteet High School's AP Scholars, Telvin Culberson. AP Scholar Maggie Graham. AP Scholar Cody McKitty. AP Scholar Miranda Rodriguez. From West Mesquite High School, Valerie Mejia, AP Scholar. West Mesquite's Jasmine Bussell, AP Scholar. From West Mesquite, Raina Habib, AP Scholar. West Mesquite High School's AP Scholar, Giselle Herrera. From West Mesquite High School, Noel Jamez, AP Scholar. And our last group of AP Scholars is from Vanguard High School, Juan Diaz. Jonathan Thomas, AP Scholar. This next group of students are AP Scholars with honor, meaning they received an average score of at least 3.25 on all exams taken and a score of 3 or higher on 4 or more of those exams. First is Sharon George from Horn High School, AP Scholar with honor. Also from Horn, Christian Molino Holden, AP Scholar with honor. From North Mesquite High School, Jose Cojeto, AP Scholar with honor. From North Mesquite, Ian Hernandez Perez, AP Scholar with honor. From Mesquite High School, Jaslyn Araquin, AP Scholar with honor. Also from Mesquite High School, Jay Lopez, AP Scholar with honor. From West Mesquite High School, Edwin Castro, AP Scholar with honor. From West Mesquite High School, Abdi Hernandez, AP Scholar with honor. West Mesquite High School's Leonardo Juarez, AP Scholar with honor. From Vanguard High School, Angel De La Fuente Treviso, AP Scholar with honor. Also from Vanguard, Jacob Torres, AP Scholar with Honor. And now we're to the students who are AP Scholars with Distinction. They received an average score of at least 3.5 on all AP exams taken, and scores of 3 or higher on 5 or more of these exams. From John Horn High School, this is Bethany Cavett, AP Scholar with Distinction. From Horn High School, Ryan Edward, AP Scholar with Distinction. From Horn High School, Sophia Isabel Garcia, AP Scholar with Distinction. From Horn High School, Natalie Serrano, AP Scholar with Distinction. From Poteet High School, this is David Pace, AP Scholar with Distinction. All right, this next student is an AP Scholar with Distinction, Christopher Rollins. He's from Poteet, but he is also a recipient of the AP Capstone Diploma, which is a major accomplishment. It's granted to students who earned a score of 3 or higher in both AP Seminar and AP Research, as well as 4 other AP courses or exams throughout high school. From Poteet High School, Matthew Weaver, AP Scholar with Distinction. From West Mesquite High School, Carla Ramirez Gonzalez, AP Scholar with Distinction. All right, next is Jason Romero of West Mesquite High School, an AP Scholar and also an AP Capstone Seminar and Research Certificate winner. He was granted to students who earned a score of 3 or higher in both AP Seminar and AP Research. Same honors for West Mesquite High School's Jennifer Tercero, AP Scholar and AP Capstone Seminar and Research Certificate winner. Another double award here from West Mesquite High School. This is Cynthia Acosta Lopez. She is an AP Scholar with Distinction and an AP Capstone Diploma recipient. And her sponsor, Alyssa Boyette, is here with this evening. And we have 2 more teachers to recognize this evening. 2 of our teachers have been promoted to the highest level of the ETIP program and are now recognized as district scholars. Please welcome Dr. Demetria Waters from Mesquite High School and Dr. Timothy Newville, West Mesquite High School.
You know what? I forgot to, in our board moment, to recognize our PTA president of Mesquite, Ms. Josie, if you'll come up here, please. Carden. It's Carden, am I right? Thank you.
Greetings to the board, Dr. Rivera. It's a pleasure to be here. I come with good news. We have started off our school year strong this year. Every year, our locals have to attain certain standards of affiliation to remain active as PTAs and to stay as a nonprofit through the IRS. And so far, we have three schools in our district that have just surpassed the rest and knocked out all the requirements. And so I want to make a special recognition for those schools, and that would be Tysinger Elementary, Mackey Elementary, and Shaw Elementary.
Cool.
I expect all of our schools to follow in their direction, but these three just knocked it out really quickly, so a big shout out to them. We are still pushing our membership drives. Our locals are working hard at that, and I want to shout out to these six schools so far that have surpassed last year's membership numbers already. So we're just now in September, and they've already got more members now than they had all of last year. And those schools are West Mesquite High School, Agnew Middle School, Galloway Elementary, Tysinger, Porter, and Shaw. So those schools have really hit the ground running with our membership drive, and I'm happy to share that with you. And just to put one more school out there, because I feel like this school has done amazing with their membership. They're not at a point where they've surpassed last year, but they had such a big number last year that they are our top membership school this year so far. That's Gentry Elementary. They have 164 members already.
Wow.
So I think that even though they haven't beat their last goal, they definitely deserve a big round of applause.
Yes, they do. Yeah.
And so that's what we're doing with PTA. We're pushing membership and we're helping schools.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, we go to our consent agenda. This is an action item. Is there a motion?
Second.
Mr. Carbo, and a second by Mr. Everett. Okay. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed by same sign. Motion carried. All right. Is there anyone here for our audience portion? Thank you. Okay. Reports of the superintendent. This is an action item.
Yes, Madam President. We have one action item, and it's the approval or the recommendation by administration to the assistant principal position of the Mesquite High School. Mr. Ricardo Pelagio, you received the bio earlier today, and this is an action item.
Do I hear a motion?
Move to approve.
Mr. Everett, Ms. Collier. Okay. Is there any discussion? All those approve, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed by the same sign? Motion carried. All right.
Mr. Pelagio, welcome back home. Stand up so you can be recognized. And I believe Ms. Job is going to read your bio.
Welcome back, Mr. Pelagio. Ricardo Pelagio has completed 11 years in the field of education. He began his teaching career as a science teacher in Dallas ISD and also served as a science teacher in Garland. In 2016, Mr. Pelagio became the lead science teacher at Mesquite High School. He also served as an instructional coach at Horn High School. Most recently, Mr. Pelagio served as a middle school and high school assistant principal in Dallas ISD. He earned his Bachelor of Arts in Biology from the University of Texas at Arlington and a Master's of Education in Educational Leadership from the University of North Texas at Dallas. He is the new assistant principal at Mesquite High School. Welcome back.
I believe right now we have a report on our resignations and new hires. Right?
That's just a report. It's not a report. It's just a report in your packet, Madam President.
Okay. All right, we need, and now we have a report from our JROTC commander. Colonel, if you will come forward, please. All right. You got a standing ovation. All right.
Good evening, Madam President, Dr. Rivera, Board of Trustees. I appreciate the opportunity to brief you all on the status of our junior ROTC program, where we pride ourselves in continuing to provide as many opportunities and options for our students to forge a path towards a better future. I'd like to first start with...
She's going, yeah.
They're working.
When it was back up, I was just checking.
It was working a minute ago, wasn't it? I think we need an NCO.
Okay. I'd like to go ahead and start with our organization chart. There are currently three vacancies shown on the organization. Two of those vacancies are by design at this point, but the Senior Army Instructor vacancy at Vanguard, we've just filled last week, so that is no longer vacant. However, Poteet High School, our Senior Army Instructor position, is currently vacant as of Friday. We're working that. We continue to move forward with our robotics program. This year, we sent four teams, to the World Championship. We also hosted the largest JROTC robotics competition in our region, which is, of course, the entire state of Texas. And we have already received over $7,000 in grant equipment from the Robotics Education and Competition Foundation as a result of our hosting of these the largest tournament. Also, we continue to move forward with the grant that was approved by the school board. Mesquite ISD was the first school board to approve the Department of Defense STEM grant. That grant will go towards our summer program. And we originally were awarded the grant for the year of 25, but last year when the grant folks came down to visit with us, they realized that Mesquite ISD JROTC was ahead of all of the 25 cohorts and most of the 24 cohorts. So when one of the 24 cohorts fell off, they asked Mesquite ISD JROTC to go ahead and move into 24. So with that, this summer we will receive over $141,000 for our summer program, and next summer we will receive over $144,000 for our summer program. We continue our partnership with Texas A&M Commerce. And this year, we have a freshman from our JROTC program that is now entering the School of Engineering at Texas A&M Commerce that attended our summer program that we're doing in conjunction with Commerce. With this grant, that'll allow us to be able to sustain our robust summer program for the next several years, even if the Department of Defense doesn't renew the grant in 2026. Just to give you an idea, we are one of 10 school districts that were awarded the Department of Defense grant. So again, puts Mesquite ISD in very, very good company. The purpose of this grant and the structural change just a little bit, one of the reasons that we were so far ahead was that when it comes to the Junior ROTC Cadet Leadership Challenge and the STEM learning, we were already performing that in conjunction with A&M Commerce. The part we'll add this year is the workforce leadership and experience, and that's where we will take our students on field trips where they'll actually visit industry within DFW Metroplex to get an idea of what type of job opportunities there are out there. They see these large buildings, these large companies, but don't realize that there are jobs that require college degrees, certifications, and some jobs that are available straight out of high school, also giving them the opportunity to speak with folks in those different industries. This year, our focus will be STEM in the air, and so we're also partnering with the Frontier Flight Museum out of Dallas at Love Field, and that will be one of the sites that we visit with the students. And that also corresponds to what we'll be doing with the teaching the students on STEM in the air. Next year, we get to choose air, ground, or water, and we've selected STEM on the ground, which will allow us to upgrade the robots that we've been using for the past 3 or 4 years to a much more advanced robot, which will allow us to allow our students to complete other more advanced challenges as we move on in the future. Just a few pictures of what we executed at A&M Commerce this past summer, everything from a drill competition, leadership challenges, robotics competitions, and this is all designed to give our students, one, we're taking them, putting them on a college campus, allowing them to experience that, being taught by college students as well as college professors, and eating in the college dining facility, and at the same time, facing challenges that most of them probably would never do, such as the rock climbing wall, zip line, and the catwalk. Taking them out of their comfort zone to push them in their leadership capacity. The other thing, we are one of 9 schools that you already know that have been selected for the cyber program. This is the first year that we actually received evaluations on our cyber program. So we had 44 students successfully complete the first year. We currently have 79 students enrolled in the first 2 years of the program. We've also partnered this year with the United States Army Cyber Center for Excellence, and so they will actually send us a guest speaker probably twice a year, again, providing our students with an opportunity to understand what cyber jobs are available within the military as well as the civilian sector. And as you all know, the cyber program, we're addressing a very critical need in the country, and in the military, there are only 2 occupations that we do direct commissions. That's doctors and lawyers. We are now doing direct commissions for cyber experts. That's just how critical that position is. Wow. And on the cyber evaluation, the end of year hands-on evaluation, our students score a mean score of 94%, which is extremely good. Also, when the cyber team came to visit us, they conducted a number of evaluations, and cyber citizenship education is one of the key things. They looked at 2 components, understanding cyber citizenship and actual cyber citizenship behavior. Our students scored above the national average on all 8 categories. One of the few school districts to do that of the 9 that are doing this program. And we continue to cultivate a culture of service within our students. We have community service and our service learning. The distinction being service learning is tied directly to our curriculum, where the students actually plan, coordinate, execute, and then conduct an after-action review on the project that they conducted. And then, of course, we have our standard community service. This year, they completed over 18,000 hours of community service and service learning, which is the highest number we've done to date. That translates minimum wage into $131,000 given back to our community and our district. But if we go with the current fast food wage, then it would be over $217,000 that our students have given back to the community. Again, thank you very much for the board allowing us the opportunity, and a lot of what we've accomplished would not have been possible were it not for this board and our district administrators. I am now subject to your questions.
This is an amazing program. You've done wonderful things. You've really kept us in the 21st century, that's for sure. Yes, that cyber program is very exciting. Board, anyone that would like to?
Thank you.
Great work.
Appreciate
Colonel.
It very much.
Thank you.
You. Yeah. Okay, our next part of our business is an action item in administration. Consider the lawsuit against the Commissioner of Education related to performance ratings under the public school accountability system. Mr. No, you're not Scott Thomas. Dr. Fineglass. Yes.
Good evening, and thank you for having me. We have a big decision ahead of us tonight.
We do.
The lawsuit that we're going to talk about, several school districts have already filed against the commissioner to prevent the commissioner from retroactively changing the measures, methods, and procedures used for the performance ratings. So tonight what we're going to talk about is the reasons for the lawsuit, the timeline for the accountability changes, the major changes that were made, the pros and cons of joining the lawsuit, and then our options. We expect to be held accountable. We want to be held accountable to high standards, and we want to be held accountable to our community. However, when we were introduced to a new STAR test this past fall of 22, which means it's called STAR 2.0. So the questions are gonna look different. The questions are gonna be harder, a different style of questions. There's gonna be writing across all the tests and all the content areas. So some big changes for both our students and teachers. When the test structure changes this drastically, it's common to see a dip in scores. So, and that's across the state, that's not just a Mesquite ISD thing. It takes time for both students and teachers to learn the new strategies, to learn the new ways, teacher trainings for what students need to be prepared for. That takes time. When you also add in the fact that the accountability bar was raised, and put on top of that, we have yet to receive the commissioner's rules for how we were supposed to be graded last year. We have yet to receive that. You're gonna expect another dip in scores any year that they raise the scores, raise the accountability. So now they've done both of these things in the same year. And of course, on top of that, as you know, we were dealing with a teacher shortage. So at a time when you would want to be able to pull your teachers, train your teachers, all of these things to help prepare them, we had to get really creative because we didn't have teachers coming in behind them to cover in the classrooms to make that happen. So what the school districts are calling this that have already joined the lawsuit, they're calling this the perfect storm. It's just painting an unfair picture of our campuses. This is the timeline for the accountability changes. Back in November of 2022 was when the superintendents were provided an opportunity to give feedback on the new A through F system. Also in November, an updated A through F framework was released. Keep in mind, this is all preliminary, this is not final. In January of 23, the preliminary targets and cut scores were released. April and May, that's when our students were testing. Just last month, the preliminary accountability manual was released for last year's test. It's still not approved. And this month, they are supposed to release the A through F ratings. So the major changes that our campuses and district have been faced with is mainly in, we're looking at CCMR, which is College Career Military Readiness, and then we're also going to talk about Closing the Gaps, which is Domain 3 and accountability. So the threshold score to get an A for CCMR increased 28 points. That alone is a very difficult thing to do. However, you also have to know that this is a lagging indicator, which means it's a year behind. Then, indicators that counted then at that time are no longer going to count now. So, the students earned the score, they earned the CCMR point that counted. Those students have graduated and gone. And now TEA is saying some of those points are not going to count. On domain 3, it moved from a yes-no to a 0 through 4 point scale, and we are still unaware of those targets. It changed from 25 tests to 10 tests. And so what this means is that previously it took 25 tests in a grade level by a subgroup to count as its own separate subgroup. Well, now it only takes 10. So you have a whole bunch more subgroups that you have to hit indicators on. And also, the new changes are adding an emphasis on the two lowest performing subgroups, which puts a higher weighting of scores on these two subgroups. So for example, if you have a Hispanic student who is EcoDIS, bilingual, and in SPED, this student's score is going to count 5 to 6 times depending on where that group falls. So the way it is set up, the more diverse your campus, the more targets you have to hit and the harder it is. So with all of that, some the reasons behind the lawsuit, the commissioner intends to apply the new accountability system on a retroactive basis, and this is in violation of state law. Texas Education Code says that the school districts have to know the test and the way it's going to be graded before the school year starts. So that would have been August of last year that we're talking about. We still don't have this information now for last year's test. TEA has communicated the goal of the A through S system is to have an easy to understand accountability system that is also transparent. And you're laughing, Mr. Stewart. I'll tell you, I took doctorate level math classes and I've had a lot of trouble figuring all this out. And I've had to call a lot of people for help. TEA, as I've already said, they still have not adopted the accountability manual as of today. Because of the changes, many campuses will see a decrease in their letter grade rating. So what we are looking at is, like we talked about, because you're probably going to see a dip because it's a new test, you're going to see another dip because they raised the bar. Schools that were possibly an A one day, the next day, with no changes, nothing different, the next day they could be a B, C, or D. In a time when also the TEA and Austin, they have not increased our funding, expectations for performance continue to increase in spite of all the improvements we've made even through the pandemic. So these are pros and cons of joining the lawsuit, okay? So if we look at the pros, ensures that if a judge enjoins the commissioner for retroactively applying the new metrics, the injunction will apply to MISD. So if we join and that's what the judge decides, it will apply to us. The law firms that are involved have placed a spending cap on this, which makes it much more affordable. This is another obstacle to move the voucher conversation in the right direction. And the message to our community that we do not agree with A through F labels that many of our schools may receive. Some cons to joining this lawsuit. There is, even though the law firms have put a cap, there's still a cost associated with this. Stakeholder perception could be that it's not our role or the district's role to sue or engage in litigation against the state agencies or authorities. Limited time for you to consider a course of action. You know, in school leadership, we like to say there are very few decisions we have to make immediately. So in a perfect world, we would pull in all the stakeholders. We would want to hear from our teachers. We would want to hear from our principals. We would want to hear from our parents. What do y'all want to see? What do you want us to do? But due to the timing of this and due to the timing of when the star scores are going to be released, this has to be made now. And also a con of not joining is the no favorable ruling. So if the judge does side with the districts, and we are not a part of that, we don't know if he will include all districts or not. He or she will include all districts. These are the districts that have officially joined the lawsuit so far. The spending cap was just put on last week, so they are expecting many more to join this week. So these are our options. Here's what we're looking at for tonight. We can join the litigation as an intervener, option one. Option two, we can choose not to join it this time. Or option three, we can adopt a resolution in support of the districts that have joined. Do y'all have questions or thoughts for discussion?
Well, I'll start. I know that everybody has some things they want to say. As a board trustee, I have an opinion regarding this, and we discussed briefly, though the board has not made any decisions at this point. But we value and we respect the role of our governor and our lawmakers in Austin. The Commissioner of Education, Mike Morath, is an appointment of the governor of the state. And of course, we're talking partisan politics when you talk about that. The role of Texas public school districts is nonpartisan. And my opinion is that the commissioner is dragging us into partisan politics. Like you said, Dr. Fineglass, we acknowledge the need for accountability so that we can measure our progress, so that we can work on improvement where improvement is needed, so that our students are able to move forward as we expect them to. But this midstream change to the accountability system creates a false narrative that public schools in Texas are failing. And these changes that the commissioner is implementing are an injustice to districts like Mesquite that have a high percentage of economically disadvantaged students. And we talked earlier, this is not a frivolous lawsuit. We're very serious about this. But this lawsuit that we're potentially, we're gonna vote on in a few minutes, and I don't know which way this board's gonna go, but it challenges the commissioner's changes to the 8F accountability system by him illegally failing to notify districts of the changes to these domains that we have. These changes arbitrarily lower performance ratings of individual schools and school districts as well. And the result of these changes will allow lawmakers in Austin not to criticize them, but it allows them to tarnish the reputation of public school districts and educators throughout the state of Texas. This is serious business. And it allows lawmakers justify withholding of funds from public education and gives them a reason why they want to implement publicly funded voucher systems in the state of Texas. We think the commissioner needs to do the right thing and reassess these changes and give us an opportunity to meet the standard and the domains that have already been set that we've agreed to.
Thank you. One thing I wanted to say too, the CCMR, you can't win. It is a no-win situation because it's a year lag. Mm-hmm. So we can't go back and fix what he said CCMR is supposed to be. We can't. We have to accept what it is, and he's not even going to accept some of what the kids have earned. So it's a very, very troublesome item that we're facing here.
Yes, you said that exactly right.
Mm-hmm. Madam President, Mr. Everett, I agree with you. You took some of my notes, didn't you? I do want to make some comments. I wrote them because I want to make sure they're heard, because we all fear for what they're trying to do in Austin. And the comments I have here is, a district, we are ready, willing, and able to comply with the scoring system. But we believe in being rated, but we want to be held accountable. But we simply want to enforce a state law that exists that provides adequate notice so that we know the rules of the game before we play it. You know, I don't know any entity that believes it's fair to change the rules of the game literally after the game has been played. You can take football as an example. They changed the scoring structure after the season. Everybody be it up in arms on that. This is exactly what Commissioner Morath has done, and it's an injustice to our schools and to the hard work of our staff and our students. This is an attack on our public schools, and it aligns with what we saw in the legislative session. In Mesquite, we pride ourselves in setting high standards for our schools and students. At the same time, the accountability system must be fair and clear and transparent expectations for our educators and our students so that they have a realistic opportunity to strive to meet those goals. You know, my opinion is this, that the new 2023 A through F ratings are set to be released to the school districts on September the 26th and to the public on September 28th so that it corresponds with a special session being called by the governor on vouchers. But no matter what the outcome, we remain steadfast in our mission to provide outstanding education to every student. By challenging this accountability system adjustments, we aim to prevent a scenario in which our district is inadvertently penalized by the changes that do not accurately capture the students' achievements. As they say, nothing ever good comes from an action that appears to lack transparency.
That's right. Mr. Carbo.
We talk about accountability, and we've said that in this dais before. Some of us have been here 25 years, a little more, and we've seen the evolution of these accountability tests. And the truth is, and we've said it before, we're not afraid of accountability, but the truth is, the spirit of this test is really to help our kids graduate with a chance to have a good life, be a career, or serve in the military and be successful, and mainly go to college and be good students, graduate, and come back to your communities and be of some good. They have been changing these tests regularly. And, you know, the first time the change is made, you have some difficulty, and we've seen that. But we immediately, 2 years later, 3 years later, we're already caught up with it. So the state changes it again. And there was a time when they were changing every 5 years. Mesquite ISD never shied away from them, complained, and we progressed and we caught up. But this change here is not about the students and making them better. This change here is about making public education look bad in Texas. So that the rhetoric that the governor has been throwing out there to the wind sticks. And they have the opportunity to do that. They have the power to do that. And they don't want to listen. And we talked about the luck I have that I sit on a state board, which has given me the opportunity to talk to Commissioner Morath a couple of times. And in those conversations, I had come to the assumption that, or to the point that I understand that he doesn't want to really help out public education the way he should. I don't think he's being fair to public education. I think that all these actions speak louder than words, and they show that public education is being attacked. And we have to come and fix it, and we have to deal with it. But our side is mainly at a higher level. The ones that are really suffering here are the kids and the teachers that have to apply all this. And I could tell you stories about kids. They come hurting to their houses. Excuse me. They don't want to take the test. They have a hard time. It's incredible what they go through. And he wants to make it worse? Come on. Michael, please. I could only just tell you it's not right. And he has to change his tone sooner or later. This is going to come out. It's going to be really bad for everybody. Thank you.
Thank you. I agree. Mr. Bingham?
I, of course, echo all that's been said. This is a very political environment, and we know that. I do hate what it's doing to the morale of our teachers and our kids. But as we thought about this, this is basically boils down to this. There is a law. Commissioner Morath did not obey the law. He did not follow the law, and the only relief we have is to join in this lawsuit. That's simply it. He did not follow the law. He needs to be held accountable to following the law and give us the shot, equal playing ground. That's the bottom line.
Our job, our role is to protect, shield, advocate. And when somebody changes the rules midway and says, oh, our bad, we're gonna do it this way, even though we said we're gonna prepare you to do it this way, and we're gonna lay all the groundwork for you to do it one way, and then we're gonna change the rules, not tell you what the rules are, and then say, when it's convenient, we're gonna tell you the rules. There is no way I'd let my kids play that game. There's no way. I would figure out whatever I needed to do to ensure that I created an even playing field, or the best playing field I could, or even prepare them with the tools that they needed to be able to have to play that game. And we can't even prepare for it. I am not a fan of litigating when I don't get my way. That is not something I am on board with. So I have definite hesitation with that being the course of action. But there also isn't really another course of action. Because if you see something wrong, you just stand there and look at it, you're complicit in it. If you see the harm and you see the kid running into the street and you don't try to stop him, that's on you. So I don't see another way to go around this. But I am not a fan of litigating my way out of problems. But this, it's like tying your hands behind your back. Yeah, it's pushing it, and it's made it so that there's no time window to even be able to stand up for ourselves. Because it's our kids. It's literally, they woke up one day, and I got three. I remember getting up for star test. And I shouldn't have to work my own kids through a process so they can get ready for a test that they've been preparing for weeks for. I shouldn't have to do that. The test isn't to test somebody. The test is so to say, hey, you know what? You're doing a good job, or you're not doing a good job. This is what you need to work on. But if you set up people to fail, then, you know, you rigged the game from the start. So I think we should do it. Not easily, but I think we should do it.
You know, one of the things that makes me sad about all of this and being an educator, et cetera, is we are sitting here talking a little bit about politics. It's being thrust upon us. What, and everybody sitting on this board, what is the main thing we're here for? The kids, okay? And they are pushing us politically to make our kids look bad. Shame on them. Shame on them.
This is an action item.
Okay. Oh, I was just going to. Yeah. I'm ready to make the motion if you're ready to hear it. I make a motion that we join in the lawsuit through the TSA group.
Second.
We're joining the TSA group.
Yeah. We're the TSA group, yes, yes. Is there any other discussion?
The consequences of us entering this lawsuit.
That would be a Scott.
That was a consequence.
Yeah. How soon will we know what the results are?
I have no idea.
We don't know?
Well, the case will be heard on Monday, so that's the earliest that we'll have a hearing. Then if there is any action taken, it'll be either TRO or not, and it'll go forward. There may be a TRO on Monday, temporary restraining order, or not, and then it goes forward.
Mr. Thomas, we were given three different options that Dr. Fineglass conveyed to us earlier, but we have sample motions. Does Mr. Bingham need to do that according to the sample that we have?
Didn't see that.
Yeah.
It's more specific language.
Yes. So specifically in your motion that was suggested to join the TSA group, if you just wanted to clarify what that TSA group is, they're the group that is represented by Thompson and Horton.
Okay. Do you want to withdraw the original motion?
No, I don't want to withdraw my motion.
You want to re-say?
Can we amend it?
I will amend it.
Correct the motion?
I will amend it to say I move to adopt a resolution to join the lawsuit against the Commissioner of Education related to performance ratings under the public school accountability system and engage external counsel to represent the district in the lawsuit. And my motion would also include that that's the TSA group with Thompson Horton.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And there was a
I was just going to say, and forgive me, I get very passionate when somebody's attacking my kids and I really can't do much about it. But we have 38,356 kids that we have to look for. Look after. And
I would say this, we don't take any pride in having to sue the Commissioner of Education.
No.
This should never happen.
No, I agree with that.
You need to get Tia to second his correction.
Okay. Tia, you need to second his correction.
Second.
Okay. A motion by Mr. Bingham, a second by Ms. Collier. Is there any further discussion?
Well, as I said earlier, we value the commissioner and his work. He should be a partner of every public school district in the state of Texas. And we're just asking him, as joining this lawsuit, to please hear us and make the playing field level with the public education and
our kids.
Charter schools, private schools, whatever.
I think we're just asking to play fair.
Yes.
That's what we're asking for, to play fair. Let's do it.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign. Motion carried.
I just want to say from the teachers, the principals, the students, the community, thank you for your support and thank you for your passion.
Thank you. Okay, and we move to instruction. Our summer academic programs, including accelerated instruction report by Mr. Willis. Ms. Willis. Ms. Willis. No, there you go. Oops.
Hello.
Hello.
Good afternoon, Dr. Rivera and school board. After all that, we have some exciting things to talk about. Our summer programs, the things that we do offer for our students in the summer. Mesquite ISD provides a variety of summer programs for our students. This year, we continued with recovering loss in learning and learning opportunities like credit recovery, which allowed students to recoup credit that was lost during the school year. Students were also given the opportunity again to receive extra support and work on their House Bill 4545, which changed to House Bill 1416 hours, by working with some of our best and most passionate teachers. Our summer programs give students an opportunity to work in a small classroom setting, which focused on their individual growth and progress. MISD summer programs extend and support student learning on all grade levels. This past summer, our elementary program changed a little bit and started in July rather than June. And this was a response to a teacher feedback form that we had last year. This year, we also offer credit recovery at each of our high school campuses and at Mesquite Academy. Traditional summer school offered courses for original credit to students who wanted to get ahead or to make room in their schedule for other courses during the school year. 476 students were enrolled this year, which was an increase of about 75 more students than last year. And I believe that this is because counselors promoted it on their campuses, and as a district, we promoted it on social media like Facebook. Summer PE was offered to give students the opportunity to receive a full year of credit. This enables students to fit other courses such as band and art into their schedule during the school year. High school credit recovery. is an opportunity for students to regain credit to complete requirements for promotion. Students sometimes may encounter a variety of challenges throughout the year, which may affect their attendance and performance in school. This year, 934.5 more half credits were earned this summer than last summer. Recovery learning is for any student at risk of not promoting to the next grade, students with gaps in learning, and or students who did not perform well on STAR. Students have the opportunity again to complete all of their required House Bill 1416 hours for this upcoming school year, the school year that we're in right now. High schools did a fantastic job in getting students ready for retesting. For an example, high school EOC classes used a revised format to address the STAR redesign, and because of this, MISD students performed at the same level or outperformed the state in each of the four areas. Middle school recovery learning. We invited students to also come and satisfy their House Bill 4545 or House Bill 1416 requirements. We had 100 more students participate this year than we did last year. Some highlights for middle school recovery learning. I would like to give a kudos to Teaching and Learning as they really focused on laying out a great foundation as to what will be taught this school year. This summer, we saw growth in our pre and post test data for each of our subject areas. Elementary recovery learning. This year, recovery learning was offered on each elementary campus. Our focus this summer was on RLA, and we had more than 1,600 students attend. Here's a highlight. As you can see, overall, students who attended elementary recovery learning grew from the pre-test to the post-test across the district. Our emerging bilingual ESL pre-KK program was held at two elementary campuses, Lawrence and Hanby Elementary, where they welcomed 288 students to their campuses this summer. Students received special instruction designed to prepare them to be successful this year in kindergarten and in first grade. Fresh U is one of our programs that we choose select incoming freshmen to participate. And what it does is it connects them to our student success teachers on their campus and helps them build relationships. They learn about their schedules. It just kind of get used to high school before the first week of school. This year, we offered the program as a one-day mini camp with ongoing connection activities this first 9 weeks of school. The best part, summer graduation. As you know, we recently had summer graduation last month, and this is possible because of the recovery learning opportunities that MISD provides to our students. Without summer learning opportunities, students would have to wait till the spring to graduate. With all of that being said, summer programs is a huge task that cannot be done alone. There are several departments working together to offer summer learning opportunities to our students. It truly takes a village to serve our students of MISD, and our village comes together. Thank you so much for the opportunity to present to you tonight. Are there any questions about our summer programming? Okay.
You seem very successful. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Very nice. Now I'd like to invite Dr. Hammond out to finish our report.
Go back to that report. Okay, so this is a summer EOC testing update, as you just heard. Tests changed, so it even looked different for these students testing. We still remained above the state in several areas, but we had a lot of students come and retest this year for summer EOC. High school graduation rates continue to rise. That's a good thing for us. We always do pretty well right here, so get our kids across that finish line. And then we do have to go into hearing over the effectiveness of our summer acceleration programs.
We will close our regular meeting now and open it to conduct a public hearing to evaluate accelerated instruction effectiveness. Is there anyone here that wants to speak? Ms. Job? There's no one. We will close this hearing and open back the meeting.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. We have a report from Replay Talk. Ms. Paris. I think our mayor is a fan of yours.
I said, listen, I have a big presentation coming up tonight. If you could say something, that would be fantastic. No. President Hornsby, members of the board, Dr. Rivera, thank you for this opportunity to update you all on Read, Play, Talk and the ways that we are engaging families and educating on the importance of reading, playing, and talking with children every day. I'll start with a quick event recap from last school year. We hold two annual events every year, the Read, Play, Talk Festival, the Read, Play, Talk Fair. The festival's in the fall. Despite a very rainy week leading up to that event, we had to make some last-minute pivots. But overall, the event was, I would still consider it a success, despite the circumstances we were in. There were over 500 people in attendance. We still had a trunk-or-treat element with local businesses. And we are excited for that event that's coming up just in another month, and I'll share about that in a minute. Our Read, Play, Talk Fair was was March 25th. We had over 1,000 people in attendance. We had a sponsorship from Credit Union of Texas that allowed every family to receive a free Read, Play, Talk tote when they walked in the doors. And then we had a booth set up by Book Drive for Kids, which we've recognized at a board meeting in the past, and they had free books for kids to come, and I saw kids load up their bags with books, and so that was something that we really wanted to incorporate in our event this year, as we always have the Scholastic Book Fair, but we know not every family can participate in that, and so this was a way we could get books in the hands of every family that attended the event. I did want to touch on our summer pop-ups. We pivoted a little bit with this event. We've done this event the last three summers. They're normally held at parks. And if you know anything about summer, it's very hot here in Texas. So we had pretty low attendance in our 2022 summer pop-ups. And so we were brainstorming, how do we still hold these events but make them better? So we partnered with our public library systems in Mesquite and Balch Springs, and we held our summer pop-ups at the public libraries. We centered our times around either story times or events that they were having, and that really helped us draw a larger attendance, but also it pointed families to free resources that are provided year-round by our public libraries. They're great partners of ours. They're doing incredible work, have similar missions that we do, and so we were happy to partner together with them. Okay, I want you to think, when you were a kid, what a common question you were asked. I remember as a kid, every adult I interacted with, they're like, what do you want to be when you grow up? And anytime I'm around kids, especially pre-K, kinder kids, I'm asking them, like, what do you want to be when you grow up? Because I love to hear what they're thinking. A lot of them right now are saying, I want to be a YouTube star. I want to be an influencer. But I'll still get kids that say, I want to be a teacher. I want to be a firefighter. I want to be a graphic designer. I want to be a chef. And those are all great things. And you know this, and I know this, but a lot of families don't know that we have programs right here within Mesquite ISD that can help children reach those occupational goals. And so what we're doing this year at the Read, Play, Talk Festival is we're pivoting a little bit. We're partnering heavily with the district CTE department, mm-hmm. and we're gonna be showcasing all of these different programs that are offered for our students.
Good.
There's still, each department will have a booth space, there will still be trunk or treating, but we believe that the shift in this event will really make the Read, Play, Talk Festival feel like a district event, showcasing all of the great things that are happening within our district and all of these programs that are available to our kids. We're adding things like a kids area where the Read, Play, Talk bus will be stationed, and our family engagement team and Ready, Set, Teach teachers will be running games and activities for families. You'll still see similar components like trunk or treating at the different booth spaces. There'll still be bounce houses, a Scholastic Book Fair, representation from all six MISD high schools, food trucks, and a DJ, but we are just thrilled about this change for the event, and so we hope that you'll come out and join us. We're hoping for better weather on October 28th.
Thank you.
I did want to share kind of an ongoing project that we started at the end of last semester. You'll remember it's been over 5 years ago that we had Little Free Libraries built and installed on all of our elementary campuses. those libraries have been well-loved and utilized, and frankly, some of them needed some attention. So my department, over the last several months, we've been very intentional to make sure that these libraries are clean, that they are fully stocked, that they are organized, so that way they're inviting and just a valuable resource for families. We did have some libraries that needed some minor repairs, whether they needed to be repainted or the door needed to be rebuilt or put on. So we worked with several members from Sea Life Church. They've adopted those libraries, they fixed them up, and then they're also have committed to keep them stocked throughout the year. The other libraries that just needed like minimal restocking and organizing, all of our libraries have been adopted by either businesses, families, parents, staff members, and so every elementary library is represented by somebody in the community. So I've asked them to agree to stopping by their little free library at least two times every semester to make sure it's stocked in good condition. We really want these to be a valuable resource for our students, especially during the breaks, during the school year, Christmas break and summer break. We worked with our district communications department to create a video, a short video, to be kind of sent out on social media and also to principals to reintroduce what Little Free Libraries are to the community and how they're meant to be utilized. So I'll show that video to you now.
Introducing Mesquite ISD's Little Free Library, available to students and families at every elementary campus. Stop by and explore. You'll find a variety of subjects, stories, and different styles of books. We want you to borrow the one you want for free. Just return the book you borrowed when you are done and ready for a new one. Encouraging reading, building connections, and spreading joy. Brought to you by Read, Play, Talk and our community partners.
So that video will begin circulating on social media this week. But what we hope that this video emphasizes is we want this to be shared responsibility among our community and among our students. I know that there are going to be kids, they're going to get a book from a library and they're going to fall in love with it. And if they fall in love with it, I want them to keep that book. You know, I want that to encourage them to keep reading. And that's why we have partners who have adopted. They can restock. But we also want to hold them accountable. Hey, if you read a book, finish it, bring it back so someone else can enjoy it. So we hope that, this video will help spread that message. You don't want to watch it again, or maybe you do. Oh, gosh. Okay. All right. I wanted to touch on some of the community and school resources. We were able to do the Read, Play, Talk calendar this year, just in a different format. Our funding changed a little bit, and so we had to cut costs on that, but we were able to provide every elementary student with a Read, Play, Talk magnetic calendar for the year. We are still releasing monthly episodes of the Read, Play, Talk podcast and then quarterly editions of the Read, Play, Talk digital magazine. We provide a variety of parent education programs, Read, Play, Talk story times that we hold twice a month at Town East Mall. Starting this month, those story times will look a little differently. I felt like we were lacking the parent education component in the story times. It felt like they lasted 10 minutes. We'd have a guest reader come in and it was fun, but then they were over. So we have laid it out now where it will be 30 minutes, full interaction for families, starting with a parent socialization time that's still structured, but bringing families together. We'll still have a guest reader, but then we'll end the story time with either a craft or activity that directly relates with the book that's read. And so we are hopeful that that will just be a great parent education opportunity for the families that attend. And then, as you know, we've offered Read, Play, Talk parent classes at a district level in the past. Starting this year, we have collaborated with Teaching and Learning, specifically Andrea Bailey and her team, and they've created curriculum that campuses can use to instruct those Read, Play, Talk parent classes on the campus level. And then I'll touch on school resources, the Read, Play, Talk bus. We have decided that this school year, our department is going to pay for the bus to visit every elementary campus at least one time. We have some additional funding that we're able to do that because we want that resource to be utilized. And then we're also providing book donations. We get lots of used book donations throughout the year. Dr. Feinglass, I know I'm running probably over my time. She gave me a time limit. I think I'm going over it. Okay, let's talk about Lena Start really quickly. I'll share some data that we've gathered. We started this program in February of 2021. So this is data that we've gathered since we began that. 234 families have been served. 84% of our families graduate from the program. That's compared to Lena's 71% average for all their sites. So we're above average. And 70% of our families that participate are categorized as lower talk families. That's important. Those are the families that we want to target and get them in our programs. These are gains families are seeing from participating in the program, 22 to 27% increase in adult words, and this is just in the 10-week period. 5 to 10% increase in turns. Families are reading an average of 15 more minutes per day. And then families are seeing an increase of 26 to 28% in their child's language development. So we are confident that if families are seeing that much of an increase in a 10-week period, think of if they're still implementing those practices, what we're seeing as far as long-term gains. I know I've talked to you before about measuring our students that have participated in, or families have participated in Lena Start once they enter school. Lena has their own research team, and so I'm in communication with them on how best to gather that data. They have suggested that we wait until next school year to gather that data because we'll have a larger group of students that are school age. So, of course, I will keep Dr. Feinglass and Dr. Rivera updated on that progress. And hopefully when I'm here next year, I'll have more specific data to share. Expansion to elementary campuses has helped us reach significantly more families. And so you can read just by growing, you know, we were just doing groups by ourselves for a year, and then we've slowly been adding campuses, expanding Lena Start there. So in the spring, we had 76 families participate in Lena Start, and that was across 9 campuses. We have 9 campuses that are hosting Lena Start groups this semester. I don't have numbers for you on families participating because we have 5 groups that start this week. So, but we're expecting between 50 and 60 families will participate in Lena Start this semester. We received a grant from the Mesquite ISD Education Foundation at the end of last semester for almost $50,000, and that grant allowed us to expand Lena Start on 3 additional campuses for at least 3 years. So the 3 campuses we've expanded to are Austin, Cross, and Hamby. And then these are our participating campuses that will offer groups within this school year. So we are incredibly grateful for the board's support of this program. We believe it's working. We believe families need to hear it. We want all families, every single family can benefit from Lena Start. And so we want every family with a child under the age of 3 to participate in this program. Okay, I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Thank you so much. Yes, it's a wonderful program. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
You know, Lindsay, every time that I'm able to attend one of your events, I always see your husband and your children there, even yes. your mom and dad.
Yes. I make them come and work.
Yeah, they do a fabulous job, and you do as well. So thank you so much for all you do. It's obvious that you love what you do.
I do. Yeah. I really do. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yes. We have a report from early literacy. Welcome.
Thank you. Good evening, members of the board, Dr. Rivera. My name is Anaida Cestero. I'm the bilingual coordinator, and here with me is...
I'm Andrea Bailey. I'm the reading language arts coordinator for elementary campuses. So Anaida and I are excited about the district's renewed focus on literacy, specifically early literacy. And tonight, our hope is to show you our plan for the work this school year. Thank you to the board for making literacy a part of the strategic plan for our school this school year. Over the past few months, we've convened several committees of teacher leaders and district leaders, and they have worked on early literacy and defining our vision for the district. As you can see, it is important for our students to not just learn, but also to thrive.
In Mesquite ISD, we want our students to read, write, and communicate enough to have choices when they leave us.
Following the vision, we also have some belief statements. These statements encompasses the why we are doing it. These are critical to our success and are also reminders of who we want to be on this journey.
So research agrees that there are some specific actions that educators can take to improve early literacy outcomes. The actions are grouped and prioritized in the EAB research that we've been using to guide our work this year. And another research group from Instruction Partners has also grouped that early literacy research and prioritized different parts of it. And they have told us that and shared with us that both groups agree very specific actions are significant. Those specific actions are called levers, okay? And I know you might know science a little bit about simple machines, right? Okay, so I bet you didn't think that the reading person was giving you a little science lesson tonight. But so a lever is a simple machine, and the purpose of a lever is really to put in a little work and gain greater outcomes, right? And so that is what these three levers are. They are levers for early literacy, and they are three levers that we're going to be working on and focusing on this year. We've rolled out the first two, reading block time allocation and the diagnostic progress monitoring cycles. And on our next professional learning day, what we will be focusing on is skill-based small group instruction. The rest of the year is going to be spent refining those processes with our teachers and our campuses.
This visual shows the different paths and steps during English and Spanish literacy instruction. As you can see, there are some skill differences due to the complexity of the language systems, but they have a common goal, and that is to develop literacy or biliteracy. Our curriculums this year reflect the need for different approaches for mastery of the languages. These reflect the levers Andrea shared earlier. Our focus is to be intentional, and here are some ways that we will ensure this is happening.
All right, so remember those levers, specifically that first lever about the allocation of time in early literacy. We wanted to ensure that we clearly communicated with educators, all of our teachers, our instructional coaches, the instructional minutes for the day, and how we thought that they could allocate their time specifically. The document lays out the purpose, the time breakdown, and the instructional resources associated with that particular time of the day. And each part of this is part of the Reading Language Arts Day.
You will notice that the mono and the bilingual documents look similar, and that is because we collaborate often to ensure alignment. In addition to what Andrea just shared, the bilingual program also adheres to the dual language 50-50 model. That means that 50% of our weekly instruction is in Spanish, and the other 50% is in English. We have also designated Fridays for cross-linguistic connections. Our goal is for students to become biliterate, meaning proficient listeners, speakers, readers, and writers in both languages, English and Spanish.
So it's really important for everybody who plays a role in the health of our literacy program to understand how skills build from the earliest skill up to oral reading fluency. So we created this visual that shows the progression of skills, and it not only shows the progression of skills, but it shows the assessments that our teachers will be giving that assess each of those skills. That's very important because then it allows our teachers to know exactly which
skill is the gap. And then they will be able to pull students during small group instruction and address that gap at point of need, meaning that they will get the help that they need in reading instruction earlier rather than later.
In bilingual classrooms, we assess students in grades K through third in both English and Spanish. As bilingual educators, we know the value that our first language brings to second language learning. When teachers assess students in both languages, they get an asset-based understanding of a child's biliteracy skills. With these insights, teachers continue developing students' biliteracy skills and also ensure they receive instruction that leverage cross-linguistic transfer. As I shared before about the two different pathways for language development, we have developed a pyramid for students who are developing English as a second language. The pyramid outlines the English skills and assessments we use in the bilingual classroom. We have also collaborated to structure the school year into instructional cycles. By doing this, we ensure that teachers follow assessment guidelines and can analyze data with the cycle to be able to group students according to their literacy needs.
During our early literacy initiative a few years ago, we established campus teams to address the unique needs of students at a particular campus. The Texas Reading Academies calls that a literacy community. The community should work together to help students become literate. And we know in Mesquite ISD, our teachers believe that we don't want our students just to learn, we want them to thrive, right? So over the course of this year, the early literacy leadership team is training our campus teams so that they understand their role and can work together towards all of our students in Mesquite ISD reading. Our hope is by the end of this year, we would have 34 functioning campus literacy teams who are addressing community literacy needs and who regularly include teachers, paraprofessionals, and caregivers in that process. That's a functioning campus literacy team. Well, I know you're thinking, okay, how are we gonna get all that stuff done? That's a lot, right? But we have developed a strategic plan to support this work. One of the things that we've worked together to create was the a PL plan, or a professional learning plan, that gives campus literacy teams, teachers, administrators, and teaching and learning the opportunities to collaborate together and learn together several times across the year. And this strategic plan intentionally isn't designed to give those folks what they need in small chunks, right? So that they can have the space they need to change their instructional practices. Thank you so much for making literacy a priority in Mesquite ISD. Thank you for listening to our plan and supporting these efforts this year. We really appreciate you, and we just wanna know what questions do you have for us?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm very excited about it.
Well, thank you so much. I know, having been in the elementary world, your pre-K through three is critical to how you succeed in middle school and high school. And so we have to have a very solid plan down below. So congratulations. Let's hope that this really meets our needs.
Yeah, I think it's very important, that program. I've had the opportunity to go to some elementaries to speak or be with some of the teachers and see the kids in that program. That's the fascinating part. They have their little monitors and they have different tables and they're doing different activities at the same time. And they rotate on those activities and they move and they love what they're doing too. Maybe your enthusiasm is sticking, right? But they're really happy with the program, and so are the teachers, because the kids are really learning. Yes. That's what's important. So thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much for your time.
I saw that your caregivers are listed in your campus literacy teams. What are some of the ways you're roping people in?
So our campus teams, one of the expectations is that they would engage families across the year. Mm-hmm. And there's lots of ways that we've given them, you know, spotlighted a few ways that they could do that. We just had our meeting and we highlighted Read, Play, Talk programs, the Lena Start, the Read, Play, Talk parent ed classes that they can move to their campuses, the little readers clubs that libraries have been doing, mm-hmm. and they're trying to restart that and invite families back into the school on a regular basis. And then
also Mesquite Land Familia, we're expanding it to offer it to our Hispanic families.
Oh, I love it.
Okay, so we're trying to give campus teams, these are the opportunities that are available to you, just take advantage of those.
Oh, I love it. Cool. Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Yay. You did excellent. Thank you, Dr. Hammett. All right, we're into our construction. Our Don Poole has a report for us tonight. Oh, wow.
Oh, no. But we're here to see.
You can borrow.
Someone told me I didn't need to wear a tie because it was hot outside. So
there you go.
Mr. Poole, I believe the temperatures have dropped.
I did notice that. Well, tonight we're here to consider the approval of the GMP and the total construction cost for the employee wellness clinic for Mesquite ISD. With me tonight are Roland Gentry with WRA, Graham Bowman with WRA, Devin Sherman with Lee Lewis Construction, and Jay Russell with MISD. WRA Architects Lee Lewis and Mesquite ISD Construction Services recommend the approval of the Mesquite ISD Employee Wellness Center Replacement, GMP, in the total amount of $8,009,958, as submitted by Lee Lewis Construction, the construction manager at risk. The total price will be $9,386,325.06 for the Mesquite ISD Wellness Clinic. The administration recommends that the Board of Trustees approve the GMP and the total cost for the clinic.
This is an action item.
Move to approve.
We can make it 10.
Real discussion.
I have a real discussion item here on this one. So originally, what was it originally supposed to be?
10.5 million.
So I want that recorded. This is accurate.
Yes. And it's still the same thing, so. Thank you.
All right. All right.
Thank you, board, for joining us. I will be presenting the schematic design for Gentry Elementary. There is no relation that I know of.
No. Are you sure?
So the project itself will consist of roughly a 16,000 square foot addition to the south side of Gentry Elementary. This will be a storm shelter. Along with this project, we will be relocating the playground that are on the south end of the property to the north end, as well as creating a small courtyard between the gym and this new addition. Some other things we'll be addressing in this are items that were previously part of the facility assessment, including upgrading the chiller, the boiler, the cooling towers, and the fire alarm, as well as updating some of the interior finishes of the existing school. The addition itself will consist of 12 classrooms added on to the existing classroom wing. These will be sized for the new TEA requirements, so they will be a minimum of 800 square feet. This will increase the current capacity of the school by roughly 264 students. This addition will be completely storm shelter, and so it has all the extra amenities it needs. The generator room at the on the left side of the image will house a diesel generator that will power the building in case of emergency, as well as being sized for warming shelter as per district standards. We are also looking into investigating adding in some shelter rated windows into those classrooms to provide natural daylight in those spaces. From the exterior, we are matching existing finishes, brick patterning, and things of that nature. You can note on this image that the building will be a little bit taller than the existing building. The existing elementary school did not have a parapet. We are providing a parapet in the new addition to help cover up those new RTUs that will be servicing this area. And coming around back towards the gym, just continuing that patterning once again, you can see the windows we're providing into those classrooms, as well as a new fenced-in area in between the gym and the storm shelter. This new courtyard that kind of creates because of the gap between the gym and the classroom addition, we're looking to add in turfed, synthetic turf surfaces in here, as well as possibly some shade structures to allow this to be more accommodating for either, you know, gym functions or outdoor learning opportunities. As far as the project schedule is going, we are currently evaluating contractors for the construction manager at risk for this project, and we are scheduled to bring that to the board next month for approval. The project is scheduled to issue 100% construction drawings mid-December, December 14th, and we are currently estimating it to cost a total GMP of $12 million. At this point, I will open it up to questions.
What did you say that the was going to be on top of the roof that the parapet would be there for?
Rooftop units, the okay. HVAC systems. Okay.
By Mr. Carbo. Okay. All those approved, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, by the same sign. Motion carried.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. Graham, you're up.
Man,
all right.
Should have a PowerPoint. Appreciate the opportunity tonight to bring into you the facility assessment that we've conducted in the past 24 months. It's kind of been our show tonight. We've got Jay Russell with us, who's played a heavy part in some of the walks. If we had one more presentation, he would love to have presented tonight, but we're running out of opportunities, so we'll get started. Tonight's presentation is intended to be a general overview of the process and discuss our general findings in the assessment. So part of this particular project, we assess 53 school campuses, 21 support facilities for issues that will affect building over the next 10 plus years. The report included school input from the school district strategies, your demographer, True North safety and security assessment reports, and then including MISD departments, athletics, construction services, facility management, tech services, food, nutrition, and transportation. We categorized each of the priorities into a priority 1 through 4 according to when the district can expect to allocate resources. One of the very first steps in the process was to compare current enrollments to TEA capacity. At this point, we also compared the demographic projections on growth at each campus to determine future pinch points. In 2016, the average age of public school buildings in the U.S. was 44 years old. Your current average is 29 years, based on the amount of replacement facilities that you've put down and new facilities. So way better than the average, and not to be compared to Mesquite ISD, as great of a school district as you are.
This one was a difficult one to try to get a grasp on. The schools in red on the right side of the screen are basically anything that's received significant improvement, an addition, a renovation. It was either a new build or replacement. This is not exhaustive. It doesn't include all of the projects that facilities and maintenance has probably done in the last 10 years as well. So probably if you included those, it would touch probably every single campus and support facility in the district. So that's just a testament to how you spend the last several cycles of bond dollars. Our next step was to conduct the facility documentation phase of the assessment, which started with physical walks of each campus. Tom Simmerly with my office, he's a CA field rep with 20 years experience at WRA. Before that, he was a facility and maintenance director at Kemp ISD. And then your very own Jay Russell walked each campus as well. The evaluation of each facility takes into consideration all portions of the campus and the condition of each component on the scale of poor to excellent, and then a life expectancy tied to each level. Between site evaluations, review of existing documentation, and consultation with district departments, reports were provided for each campus to outline conditions, needs, and images with cost estimates for expected work. This is an example of the cost estimate that you'll find for each of the facilities. It explains outlining discipline, kind of what the need is, category type of need, and a priority ranking for that cost. These were some of the characteristics taken into consideration when we met to put together campus prioritization. So we looked at enrollment capacity versus expected growth, the age of facility and the time since the last improvement, weight of the facility walk evaluation issues on the 1-4 scale, safety and security needs, the ones that MISD identified, and then also that TEA has prescribed to you, and then instructional adequacy. This is the summary list that you can find in the executive report that kind of breaks down each campus into a kind of a one page, or really I think three pages, snapshot of what you can find in the rest of the thousands of pages of the report. It talks about facility age and number of portables. So youngest in green on the age and oldest in red. It talks through the building size, the previous TEA capacity, and then current enrollment. Green is under practical capacity, and then red is either teetering on the brink or is expected to go over. It has a priority ranking score in yellow. To the left side and then to the right are the four priority scores from the actual documentation. And then on the next column is a suggested replacement cost. Not saying we're asking you to replace any of those facilities, just to compare the numbers to how much you may be renovating or improving that facility, just to know what would it take to replace that facility. And then a note section that ties to a key that you'll find down below, just facts about that particular facility and maybe how it affected the ranking of that facility. General findings that we found, enrollment capacity, there's a couple of schools that you're already aware of. Demographics show that they're expected to go over practical capacity in the next 10 years. Other general findings, TEAs approved in the last 24 months, new minimum square foot requirements. So it averages between elementary, middle school, and high school, an additional four square feet per student at each of those facilities. So even on a repeat elementary school, you can anticipate it requiring to be about 4,000 square foot larger than the previous version. Other TEA updates, you're very familiar with this. This has been brought up quite a bit lately, but just any of the safety and security mandates that include, not limited to, door numbering, protected entrances, visitor management, and security cameras. Aging facility needs that were identified, replacing finishes and surface due to normal wear and tear, ADA compliance updates that are needed at some facilities, quite a bit on playground surfacing was made noted of, and then also code adoption updates. Facilities that may not have fire sprinkler in the full campus, fire alarm constantly needs to be upgraded. So there was several findings where fire alarm replacements are due, And then tornado shelters. Anytime you add on to a facility or provide a new, a storm shelter will be required.
Is that 20%?
Sir? Anytime you add a single square foot to an existing facility, a single square foot.
And that's a federal law.
It puts it under the International Building Code for new construction once you add on to it. If it's a renovation, it is currently exempt. And once you add one single square foot, the storm shelter has to serve the entire facility. So that basically puts your minimum square foot on how much you're adding to that facility.
And that's a federal law, is that right, Graham?
That is, it is an international building code that's adopted by local jurisdiction, and the state also decides a minimum. So the city actually adopts the latest version. They're on 2018 right now. They usually adopt every 3 years. So we can probably expect them to, they may skip 21, but they may adopt in the next couple of years, even retroactively to the 21.
Well, I knew when we first began having to construct tornado shelters, storm shelters, that was a federal requirement. So.
Yes, sir. And then moving on to other general findings. excuse me, end of life replacement needs, roof replacement cycle, obsolete breakers, electrical panels, and switch gears was noted on several of the projects. Rooftop mechanical units, water heaters and boilers, kitchen equipment, light fixtures, and by special request from facilities was a ATS transfer switches at each of the campuses that would allow portable generators to be plugged in the event of a single campus emergency, which could have been useful in recent weeks. So that is also within the report, the portable generators to support basically powering a school if Encore cuts the power or if it goes down. And then the bottom line, what did we find in the priority one total of potential costs that you could expect in maybe a 1 to 2 year timeline, $186 million, includes a new elementary school, a possible replacement elementary, additions to several elementary schools and a high school, and then maintenance and renovations to 5 support facilities. Priority two, within 5 years, possibly expect to spend $131 million on that. Additions to 6 more elementary schools, maintenance and renovation to 1 middle school, additions to 2 high schools, and renovations to 2 support facilities. Priority three came in at $301 million, and that would include 13 additional elementary schools additions, maintenance and renovation to 1 middle school and several supports facilities, addition to 1 high school. And then the crystal ball started wearing thin at 10 plus years and had a total of $30 million that we could foresee right now. Additional renovations to several elementary schools, maintenance and renovations to several middle schools, and one more addition to a high school. I think that one would be Vanguard at the very end of that list. So that was all I had for the presentation. Do you have any questions for me?
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
I was going to ask you, because you said the average building is 29 years. So that means we have some that are older, but we have been renovating some of those, right?
Yes, absolutely. The best example of that right now is the Linda Samples Technology Center. So an old building does not necessarily mean a negative. Mm-hmm. However, it depends on how well you've been taking care of your buildings.
And functional age would be significantly less than that.
Absolutely.
Right.
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much, Graham.
Yeah, the latest report from the big paper that we have.
We have a newest one of those, but there's been some safety and security things we've been chopping away at, and also with the addition of Gentry, because Gentry's actually there, we pushed up to priority one. So do you have a latest one with all those things off or no?
The latest report does not include Gentry or any of the previous facilities that we're working in right now, the health center, It probably does include a few of the safety and security features that we could pull out of there. I think that there was a seven or...
But it will chip away at that second to last slide that you had with the 300 added up to 648 million point eight, whatever.
Absolutely. Yes, sir. Thank you very much. If you'd like Jay to come up to the stand now,
yeah,
we can have one more question. Thank you.
We appreciate it. Thank you, Graham. Okay. Property, approve the additional square footage at Horn High School for the expansion of Fathom P. Lucas.
Ask for a little bit more square footage for the Fathom P. Lucas expansion over on the Horn High School side. We had included that with the land swap that we had done. It's just the paperwork for this 232 square feet had not been completed by the city. So now we have that, and we're asking you to approve that.
All right. This is an action item. Gary Bingham and Ms. Collier is the second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign. Motion carried.
Thank you.
All right. That was easy. All right. We have the action to adopt an order setting the ad valorem tax rate to fund the 23-24 budget. It is Mr. Prada.
Good evening, President Hornsby, board members, Superintendent Rivera. Thank you for having me here today. Today, I'm asking for you to consider adopting the tax rate that would support all of our business in the school district, maintenance and operations, and our debt payments. In front of you, you will see that our proposed tax rate is 0.69920. That is for the maintenance and operations of the school district, and 0.40 for the debt service, for a total tax rate of 1.09920. That is 18.54 cents lower than the last year's tax rate. I will answer any questions you might have.
Any questions?
All right. Mr. President, I approve the resolution to set the 2023-2024 maintenance and operation tax rate at 0.6992 cents per for the purpose of maintenance and operations, and to set the 2023-24 debt service tax rate at 40 cents for the purpose of payment of principal and interest of debt on debts.
Greg Everett. What is the last clause?
Yeah.
Okay.
Or we're approving the resolution.
I'm just looking at this recommended motion here. Vote.
You see that down there?
Well, I amend my motion to include. I move that the property tax rate increase by the adoption of tax rate of 1.09920, which is effectively a 4.21% increase in the tax rate.
Okay. Robert Smith, is there a second? Greg Everett. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed by the same sign. Motion carries.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. We will pay our bills now.
Thank you.
In front of you, you will have a report today. Mr. Greg Warner, from Managing Director from Hilltop Securities Asset Management, will do a quick presentation on our investment strategies. He has been very patiently waiting, but he has an awesome report for you.
Oh, my goodness.
And so right after that, you can approve our investment policy, Mr.
Greg. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
You have been very patient, sir. Thank you.
Good evening, all. Thank you. Thank you. Well, at least tonight we're not missing a national championship or a...
That's true.
...or a World Series game. So, anyway, thank you all for the time this evening. I've, of course, been asked to give a brief presentation. We're hoping this time to focus more on the investment strategy looking forward. In order for me to do that, I really need to lay a little bit of groundwork. So I'm going to take just a couple of minutes to review a couple of economic indicators And I've got some pretty charts and graphs I'll show you, and I'll try to break some of this down a little bit. As you probably have heard, one of the biggest stories in the economic front over the last 18 months or so has been inflation. This chart shows the consumer price index, year-over-year percent change, going back to 2018. What's really important here is if you look at the left side of this graph, 2018, 19 into 2020, very low, very stable inflation, right around 2%. We hit the pandemic, prices actually declined for some period of time. We come back out of that pandemic, start opening, and you can see that all those bars get much, much taller. A few important things, the gray bars in the middle there, those are goods prices. That reflects supply chain snarls, difficulty in reopening the economy, getting all the raw materials necessary to produce things. Heavy consumer demand, partially spurred on by fiscal stimulus and checks that are being sent out. And so that led to some inflationary pressure. You can also see the impact of Russia's invasion of Ukraine. The dark gray bars at the top of that chart is energy prices. We saw a big increase in energy prices. We also saw food inflation, the blue bars in the center there. And then the light blue bars at the bottom represent services. Well, that's, of course, as we reopen the economy, people start going on trips, taking vacations, getting out, saw a big increase in prices. So all that led to a big run-up in inflation, peaked at over 9% about this time a year ago. Well, Federal Reserve's, one of their main tasks is to maintain stable prices. Obviously, if we're seeing 9% inflation, that's not stable prices. So the Federal Reserve has to react. They react by raising what is known as the federal funds rate. This is their overnight target for short-term borrowing. It has a heavy influence on other borrowing costs, has a very heavy influence on investment earnings as well, which you'll see here momentarily. So we went from essentially a 0% interest rate environment up to today, the Fed funds target is a range from 5.25% to 5.5%. We'll just call it 5.5% for the time being. So that's obviously very important. Another big factor in the economy recently is the employment situation. As you're probably aware, finding qualified workers has become a very big challenge for employers. Been forced to raise wages, add benefits, do other things to attract and retain employees. One of the things that the Fed is trying to do is slow the job market. They believe that wage pressures are a large contributor to inflationary forces, and so they're trying to slow down growth in the job market. The chart on the left here shows the change in jobs every month. You can see that job growth has slowed, but even more recently, we're still running at 175,000 to 200,000 jobs per month. That exceeds growth in the labor force, and so that continues to put pressure on wages. The other important part is people participating in the labor force. The chart on the right here shows what is known as the labor force participation rate, which is just a measure of the population that's active in the labor force. The blue line is the overall rate, and you can see that it's rebounded slightly, but we're still well below where we were prior to the pandemic. Now, some of this is demographics, of course, as baby boomers are retiring, but it appears that a lot of those folks have actually left the labor force, retired early, left the labor force for good. One encouraging sign is the red line, which measures what's known as the prime age participation rate. This looks at folks between the ages of 25 and 54. Essentially, it's after folks are done with all their schooling and before they begin to get into their retirement years. That has actually rebounded to a record high of 83.5%. That also tells us that the big hunk of the prime working age population is actually employed. So as we look at the unemployment rate, we can see that as of August, it's about 3.8%. It's only slightly above a record 3.5%, which is the record low. You can also see that that unemployment rate has been very stable over the last 18 months or so, despite the fact that the Fed has raised the overnight Fed funds target so aggressively. The chart on the right looks at average hourly earnings. Kind of ignore the big spike and the big decline. That's a result of the pandemic. So the big spike you get is because lots of low-wage workers were forced out of work. And so what's left is higher wage workers who are able to work remotely and do virtual work. And then when you see that big dip, that's when the economy reopens and all those low wage workers come back to the labor force. But if you factor out those two things, if you look at the left side of this, you'll see that for many years we were stable at about 3% year-over-year earnings growth. Today, we're still just above 4%, been coming down gradually for something close to 6%. Again, we're seeing wage pressures that exceed historical norms, and in order for us to get back to a stable 2% inflation rate, we need to see average hourly earnings growth get back to something closer to 3%. So let's talk about interest rates for a moment. This is a chart of the 2-year Treasury yield. The 2-year Treasury yield is an important benchmark for us. It really gives an indication of short-term investment earnings and short-term opportunities. So as an investor in the short end of the yield curve, which is where we are as a district, this is a very important chart. The encouraging thing, the good sign, is that we're seeing much higher earnings potential from our portfolio. Instead of being in a 0% rate environment, we're now in a 5% rate environment. And that obviously has a very big impact on the district's earnings capacity. This is a survey of economists that Bloomberg prepares every month. They survey about 70 professional economists. This gives us some idea about what the professional prognosticators are expecting as we look out ahead. So the top section here shows their expectations for economic growth in terms of gross domestic product, the unemployment rate, and the headline consumer price index. You can see that they're expecting very, very modest economic growth. Something in the range of 2.5 to 3% would be considered pretty good economic growth. We're obviously looking at something a little bit smaller, but that's expected. That's what the Fed is trying to do. We're trying to slow down economic growth. The expectation is that it's going to gently push up unemployment and gently push down on inflation. A couple of other important takeaways here. Note the table in the section in the middle there, which is projecting the Fed funds rate. These economists expect that the Fed has reached the peak of the rate cycle. They expect that the Fed is done here at 5.5%. They expect next year, as we move into next year, the Fed will actually begin to lower interest rates and be cutting rates. You can also see that in their forecast for Treasury yields. I've highlighted the 2-year Treasury yield, which today sits right around 5%. But in this forecast, those economists expect that by the end of the year, it'll fall to approximately 4.5%. By the time we get to the middle of next year, we'll be below 4%. This is a really important indicator for us because it tells us that the professionals expect that interest rates are going to fall. And so we have to factor that into our interest rate strategy as we look ahead. So I'll set aside the economic lesson for a minute, and we'll focus on your portfolio for a couple of minutes. This is a summary table that's included in your quarterly investment report. I've included this version looking back a year, so we can compare it to where the portfolio stood a year ago versus where we are today. Portfolio at June 30th was $306 million. That's down from about $374 million the same time at June 30, 2022. You have capital project spending and a big, a fairly sizable decline in the operating fund. So the portfolio is a little bit smaller this year. The really important thing is in the middle of this chart, and that's investment income. I'm going to stand here with good news today. So I was going to be cheering until your construction guys showed you exactly how much money you're going to have to spend for the next few years. But in the fiscal year ended June 30, the portfolio earned about $10.5 million, $10.5 million in investment income. Now, from your all's perspective, that's essentially free income, right? You have these funds set aside, you're not spending them right away, they get to earn something for you during the time that you hold them, you're earning $10.5 million. The same period ended June of 2022, coming out of a 0% rate environment, you earned about $1.1 million. So we're quite literally earning almost 10 times as much income this fiscal year as opposed to the prior fiscal year. Looking ahead to fiscal 24, we expect the portfolio income is going to approach $15 million. Basic simple math, you have a $300 million portfolio. It's earning at about 5% currently, $15 million in investment income. Now, I do expect that by the time we get into fiscal 25 or 26, it's likely that's going to decline again, but fiscal 24 should be a peak year of investment income for the district. The weighted average yield in the portfolio, which at June 30 of 2022 was 0.84%, is 5.16% at June 30 of this year. We also have a very short average maturity. That's really important. If you go back to 2022, we had a 56-day average maturity. We had a very short portfolio maturity. It was intentional because we recognize that we're at a 0% rate environment and rates are rising. So we want the portfolio to be very short so that we can roll it over and start to achieve those higher interest rates. We're able to do that. Currently, that portfolio remains very short, about 58 days. But as we look ahead, I'm talking about interest rates falling next year. It's not going to take a genius to understand that we want you to begin to extend that portfolio maturity. We want to be able to lock in some of these interest rates above 5% so that we can retain that earning power for as long as we possibly can. So we're working with Mr. Prado and others in the staff, looking at some cash flow modeling, looking at some estimates on your spending, both capital projects and operating and debt service, trying to get a good idea of just how far out we can take those investments, how much we could lock that income in. Now, your portfolio, your investment policy provides some pretty stringent limitations. We can only go out as far as 2 years, but we do want to begin to extend some of these portfolio maturities as we look ahead. Real quickly, I'll just give you a little comparison of where we were in June of 22 versus where we are today in terms of the portfolio allocation. A couple of highlights here. June of 22, about 15% of the portfolio was invested in with banks and certificates of deposit. That's completely gone away in June of 2023. Quite simply, banks did not keep up with the rapid increase in interest rates. They weren't willing to adjust their deposit rates quickly enough. So we let those funds mature and we took those into other instruments. Primarily that went into agency securities, U.S. government agency securities. We also have a fairly sizable increase in your local government investment pools, the LGIPs. These are essentially overnight investments for you, money market mutual funds essentially. Again, this is another area where we want to begin to shift that portfolio as a look ahead. It's something that has allowed the portfolio yield to rise very, very quickly, but looking ahead, it would also lead it to fall very, very quickly if we maintain this stance. As you look at the maturity distribution, you'll note that 65% of it is in overnight investments. Those are those local government investment pools. Another 10% matures within 3 months. So about 75% of the portfolio would currently roll over within 3 month timeframe. That's extraordinarily short. And again, that's something that we're going to be working to change over the course of the next quarter or two. The other thing I'll point out here is we don't currently have any investments beyond the 1 year mark. So all of the portfolio is inside of 12 months. And we definitely want to begin to get some exposure in that 1 to 2 year area. We want to be able to lock in at least some small portion of the portfolio so that we can protect its earnings going forward. And then this is the last one I'll look at. This shows your portfolio yield versus some of the benchmarks. Those benchmarks include TexPool, which is one of those local government investment pools, the 6 month constant maturity treasury, the CMT, and the 1 year. You can see the red line, your portfolio has kept pace almost right in line with those. That, of course, is to be expected when the big percentage of your holding is in one of those local government investment pools. We would expect your yield to match that. The good news is we've been able to ride that yield curve up very rapidly. We've increased the yield on portfolio by over 500 basis points in about 18 months' time. But looking ahead, again, we want to be able to protect it and so that we don't fall as quickly as those benchmarks if rates begin to fall next year. And that's really it for my comments tonight. I'd be happy to answer any questions if you have any.
So even if CDs were available to us, we wouldn't have any better performance than what we see now?
No, sir. We've moved away from certificates of deposit because they're not providing us any advantage. So.
Percent, but the other side is probably thinking the same thing. Why will I sell that long? Because if interest rates are going down, it's not beneficial for the other side.
So right now, the yield curve is what we call inverted. So mm-hmm. as you go out, yields actually begin to fall okay. because the market is anticipating in the future that those rates will begin to get lower. So we've already sort of come over that peak. But it's a counterintuitive process, right? When interest rates are zero and the market expects rates are going to climb, yields will be higher. What happened to us over the course of the last 18 months is yields have climbed much more quickly than anyone expected. And so those that stepped out the yield curve fell behind very, very quickly. Okay. So we were fortunate to have been short. We were able to ride that up very, very quickly. But looking ahead, you know, we can still lock in investments at yields around 5%, and we think it's a good time to do so. Now, having said that, we are going to be taking yields that are lower than what we're earning today in the money markets and the local government investment pools. So text pool is a prime example today, is yielding around 5.25%. And I'm talking about locking in investments at 5%, perhaps slightly below 5%. Okay. So I know that I'm going to take a lower yield today. My expectation is that I'll be benefited from that in down the future.
Oh, that, you just answered it. That was it.
I noticed the commercial paper was reduced in half percentage-wise as far as the allocation.
Yes, sir.
Can you explain why?
Yes, sir. The primary issue with commercial paper is that we're not seeing as much issuance. So to Mr. Carbo's point, largely, corporations took advantage of the 0% rate environment to issue a lot of debt, extend their maturities at low interest rates, and now that interest rates are higher, we're not seeing nearly as much issuance from the commercial paper community. So we've sort of been forced to trim our holdings because it's not available to us.
So if the guess is wrong, we can pivot a little bit?
Pardon?
If it doesn't happen like we're guessing it's going to, we can pivot back?
Once you make that investment, we generally will hold that investment to maturity. Now, having said that, we're not talking about taking the entire portfolio and putting it out there.
Okay.
We're trying to extend a portion of it. The district's spending needs, your capital project spending, and your operating spending, those are going to limit your maturities. Those are going to limit your options to begin with. Right now, we're holding additional cash that we don't expect will be needed over the next 6 to 9 months. It's those funds that we want to focus on moving a little bit further out the curve. We also like to do what we call laddering, which is where we take investments and we stagger them so that we have amounts maturing essentially each month. So think of it as $10 million per month for the period from 12 months to 24 months. So even if we're wrong, we're not wrong with all of it.
Yes, that's what I wanted to hear.
All right.
Thank you very much.
This is an action item to review and approve investment. Yeah. Well, he just did the report.
No, he just did the report.
But so does Mr. Prado have to do this? Okay. All right. Okay. Here's Mr. Prado.
Well, thank you very much. That was very enlightening. I hope that served some of the purpose that you were requesting. We work very closely with Greg in determining our investment options, and we'll continue to do so, and they're doing a great service to the district, so they are earning their money. I want to now on the agenda, it is to accept the investment policy. There has been no major changes to the policy, so that we are asking you to consider approving the policy.
Second.
Okay. Action item to approve investment policy. Mr. Carbo, and second by Ms. Collier. All those approve?
Aye.
Say aye. Opposed? Same sign. Motion carried. All right. Next action item, budget amendment 2.
Thank you very much again. This is the approved budget amendment number 2, and there's 2 items on there we've discussed previously. One is we are recognizing the revenue coming in from the change to the security allotment. That is $15,000 per campus and a few other cents associated with that. So that is $790,000 in revenue that's coming from the state. We're also expensing that to pay for the security contract we approved earlier last month. In addition to the revenue, we are getting $141,850 from a grant that was presented earlier, and you approved it last month. Again, that is revenue, and we're also allocating those resources so that they can spend it on the STEM for the JROTC program.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Gary Bingham, this is motion. Second, Mr. Seward. Okay. All those approve, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carried.
Thank you.
I don't like this thing. Yeah. Is there any other, Ms. Job, is there anything else? Yeah. We are adjourned at 9:14.